such small sacrifice. You've not joined with my life. I sing in vain tonight. Sing the words I say.
That they were making were not real wise, and And they're going to have to learn, you know, for themselves, you know, due to, you know, decisions that they make. But also recognize that there's going to be a time when they're going to realize that, and you know, what age is that going to be, and you know, what's going to be available, what's going to be there for them, you know, when they see me, you know, like, I, you know, went to a small school a few years back, and I recognized, you know, the consequences of some decisions, and you know, I need to do something now to start earning a living and have a career and all. And I want to say that's probably what eventually had me thinking about this. I've known some young folks that have, you know, were in that situation. And so I thought, you know, that you know, it'd be good to provide some affordable skill set training. I know in the trades, there's a big demand for folks working in the trades. Electricians, plumbers, average age, you know, today is about 57 years old. And the Texas economy is booming, you know, compared to other states. And there's a demand for skilled craftsmen. And you can have a really good career in the trade. You know, electrician and plumber, if a person's willing to work hard, they need to have a very comfortable life, you know, and have, you know, to learn these skill sets. So the idea was to provide training, craft training, at the most affordable price possible, and in many cases, it's free to students. And that's made possible through scholarships. And these scholarships are offered by different individuals and companies. This semester, Christensen Air Conditioning and Plumbing provides scholarships to pay the tuition for two students. And then the Gagne family had provided the scholarship funds needed to pay the tuition for two additional students. So we're really, you know, we really appreciate that. And this is all, you know, volunteers. And Free Life Ministry is a 501c3. There is a board. And so there are folks that I'm a congregant to. And there are folks that help sponsor the students. Another organization that has been instrumental in getting this thing kicked off the ground is Hill Country Bible Church. They saw the vision and worked with me on a couple of weekends kicked off. And this is through the community impact organization there. And Tom Loss, who is the community impact director, he helped me out with this in a great way and bringing this curriculum to the Grace Family Resource Center. So that was the idea, to provide affordable skill set training, but not only skill set training, but faith-based. You know, we want to, you know, the Prayer Life Ministry doesn't only want to try to teach a skill trade, but also wants to share the love of Christ with the students that are coming to class. And so that's what the, you know, that's kind of the genesis of the Prayer Life Ministry. As I mentioned, the trades are in need more and more of skilled craftspeople. The baby boomers today, you know, we are retired. And, you know, before the economy turned south, you know, we had young folks working side by side with the older guys and learning their skills, you know, from the older men, you know, that were on the job sites in the trades. But when the economy turned, a lot of these young folks didn't really have, you know, the experience at all. They got let go. And those craftsmen that were blessed to continue working, well, now they're getting ready to retire. And so there's a gap right now. We are facing a gap, a shortage of skilled craftspeople, whether it's plumbing, electrical, carpentry, welding, there's a shortage. So there's an opportunity here, and there's an opportunity to make the news for that. So that's how this thing started. I have a background. I came down to Austin area, Central Texas, in 2001 when the electric market was opened. And before coming down here, I worked in a power plant. I was in a power plant as an electrician. I was a senior electrician and a senior operator at a 700 megawatt plant up in the Dallas area. And at that power plant, we have a lot of motors. You can probably imagine we have 4160 motors. That means we have motors that are 4160 volts. They're big motors. They used to pump water into the power plant. They used to pump lake water through the power plant for cooling. They're used to operate forced draft fans to pump air into the boilers. There's a huge motor, very high voltage. We also have 480 volt motors in the power plant. And these are used to pump or to operate smaller pumps. They're used to operate smaller fans. And they're used to operate motors to turn valves, big valves. And all of these are controlled by a group of folks working in the control room. So they can operate, they can turn switches in the control room, and they're operating all these devices and all this equipment on the power plant. Well, back in somewhere around the mid-1990s, I was teamed with a couple other guys, and we were tasked to change out a 40-volt motor control center. And I'm not sure if the motor started over here, and I didn't wait for it over. Guys, students in my class will look for the motor started inside. But it's a big contactor that you got hot wires that come into the top of it, and then you have wires that leave the contactor and goes through the particular motor, okay, whichever motor that is. And the mechanism, so there is a switch that you turn and you close this contactor and you can make this power go to that piece of equipment and start that piece of equipment. So anyway, like I said, we were tasked to change up the motor control center, which is a room maybe about 25 feet long and narrow, maybe about 12 feet wide. And it was just enough space to walk down the center of it. You walk into the building, you just walk down the center. On each wall, there's all these contacts, all these motor starters. And what we're challenged to do is to disconnect all the cables, all the control wiring, all the alarm wiring, all the signal wiring, all the power wiring, disconnect that from each one of those motor starters. And I want to say it was probably, 150 motor starters in that room right there, 75 on each wall. And the idea was we had to disconnect all those wires. We had to kind of get them back out of the way. And then we had to move forward and remove all the boxes that the motor starters were in. And we had to remove the shell, the housing itself, build a new house, and take brand new motor starters and reinstall, and then figure out which wire went to which motor starter and all those things, Well, this power plant was probably built in 1960. I want to say it was about 1960. And it was commissioned, I believe, in 1961. And so this is 1995-ish when we got this job. And so the power plants in Texas, they are exposed to the elements. They're outdoors, not like the power plants up in Minnesota. These power plants, all your equipment is outside, exposed to the elements. And so in the wintertime, it can get pretty cold in the Dallas area. In the summertime, it can get pretty hot. And so over 35 plus years, you can imagine the experience. temperature changes that that all this equipment is exposed to, including the conductors, the wires. So when we had this job to change out this motor control center, we got all the wires out of the way. We got all the motor starters out of the way. We brought a crane in and we lifted the house up off the ground to get it out of the way. And as we did, we had to be kind of on the inside fishing the wires so they wouldn't come up on anything. And then, and these wires, like I said, they go to all the equipment to go out the power line. And they come over to this motor control center, this house, through a trench. And this trench is covered by a deck plate, a metal plate. And so it's not really protected by anything. It's just you know, as far as temperatures go, you get dirt and water and you know, of course, the heat and the cold and everything in there. And so what we learned is that when we got the house out of the way and we started looking at all these cables and trying to figure out which cable was to what, you know which motor. Every time we picked up the cable, the insulation that protects that wire, you know, it would break. And it would crumble and snap off. Right? And so that was a problem because it was not in our budget to pull all the wire off for every circuit throughout the power plant. It wasn't, you know, for material and for labor. You know, that was not in the budget. But this is what we had. We had this situation here where the wires now have all the insulation broken off. I'm sorry about the lights. I don't know where the switch is for these things. But thanks, Rico. But this is what happens then. So now you got the conductor, you know, that carries all the power. You've got it exposed, right? And so when you hit that switch, you know, what the power is supposed to do when it comes out the other end from here at this machine, you know, from the source, from the power source, it's not it's not gonna do what it was installed and intended to do, right? It's gonna get shorted with another wire, it's gonna touch some of the some metal casing somewhere in the motor control house, and it will get grounded. And so the power from the source is not going to come out and do the job it was intended to do. We are a lot like this conductor. We have a power source inside of us. And that power source is Christ. God's Spirit lives in each one of us. And just like this wire, we are here for a purpose also. Right? We are here for a purpose also. And it says in Jeremiah 29:11, I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and plans to give you a future. Okay? And so we have a purpose. And but there may be folks that say, we just don't know my situation. And I'm here to say, you might be surprised. I know a little bit about fire and rain. And you say, well, you just don't know. I've experienced a lot, you know, and times have been tough and those things, you know. And maybe you feel like you just don't have any insulation at all. You know, and you feel like, you know, where do I get that hope back then? You know? And I just want to share with you that if you begin by letting the Spirit of God into your heart. You start to do that, you start putting on insulation, right? Put on the insulation. And an empty heart, then you talk to them. You can go to church on Sunday. You can read the Bible and learn more about who He is, right? What else can we do? Anybody want to share some thoughts on this? Anybody have some thoughts? Because we need to be insulated. We need to keep ourselves insulated. A lot of things in the world that will take us away from the reason why we're here, the purpose that we're here. But if we seek Him, He's going to start building up that insulation. This is where we come into this world, man, right here. Come into this world at this end of the conduit. And there's a day when each one of us will come out this other end. And we're, you know, what's going to happen to us at that point? How do we live our lives? What have we done to prepare for that day? Right now we're living this life, you know, here on earth. And then after we come out to the other end of the conduit, you know, there's a place waiting for us. Right? There's a place waiting for us. But how are we going to get over there? How do we get over there? Because in between the place that's waiting for us and where we are today, there's a big drop. A big drop. It's called hell. But through God's word, He tells us in the Bible that there is a way to be prepared for what happens after we come out this other end. And that's in the Son of Jesus Christ. So all these students, you're young, you got the whole future ahead of you. And I want to encourage you to think about this. That decisions you make and the people you hang out with, those who you take your advice from. To me, the internet is a really scary thing. Back prior to the Industrial Revolution, sons and dads, uncles and granddads, everybody worked together out in the field. Young boys learned skills from the older men. And we got away from that. And to me, I think one of the biggest things that is really hurting the fabric of our culture now, I think, is some of the technology that's out there. Facebook. 500 Facebook friends. And I question, how does mom and dad stand a chance of having influence over their children when they have 500 Facebook friends from all over the world? Because two people have I'd be aware of that. So young men, when you settle down and you start having families and all, be thinking about that. Think about these technologies and the direction it's going and, the importance of family and how some of these technologies could have an impact on how you raise them. You still have one food up there if anybody's hungry. Please, I don't want to take it home. And so let me tell you a little bit about NCCER. NCCER, when this ministry started, I was using a different curriculum altogether. And it was not accredited. I like the curriculum very much. It had good flow, it had good illustrations, and PowerPoints, and I know Michael, who has dedicated his whole life to writing curriculums and training electricians to become journeymen and masters and all. As I'm on this journey, learning how to do this, it's not my, I don't get paid for this. What I do to get back to the community and I enjoy so much. So to me, I strongly feel that it's important to give back to the community. And it's important to share the love of Christ with other people. And also I do this to honor our vets that are fighting overseas wars on our behalf, that are being pulled out of our communities to fight for us for the freedoms that we originally enjoyed in other places of the world. And so, if they're going to do that for me, then I'm going to do this for them. So I'm not teaching that curriculum. After learning how to move forward with this ministry, I learned that it would be a great benefit to have an accredited program. And so, researching that is how I talked to associate builders and contractors in Boston, and I talked to the National Center for Construction Education and Research, NCCER. And NCCER is the organization that provides all the accredited trade curriculums to colleges, trade schools. That credential that a student receives from NCCER is recognized across the country. A student that completes a curriculum, an NCCER curriculum, is put in a national database where any employer anywhere in the country can look at that individual and see what that person had taken and how he did on his grades. Okay. So I went and I became qualified to teach the curriculum. And so that's what I've been doing the last couple of semesters. And I'm hoping I'm getting better at it. I don't know. But we kind of have a system now on how I'm teaching this. And I don't mean to make it difficult for anybody, especially level one. But there are rules to have to follow at the state. I have to follow some guidelines, to get that accreditation So classes were not always that easy. There were some challenging times, but I think there were some fun times too. And so, everybody, we have 4 out of 5 students that completed. And both the core curriculum and the electrical curriculum. Let me explain that for a second. To get that credential from NCCER, the electrical level 1, each student must complete another book that's called CORE. CORE covers a lot of safety information, a lot of OSHA information, a lot of hand tools, power tools, and so we talk about it and we also demonstrate these skills. And that's what you've seen on the PowerPoint presentation earlier. And so we have 4 students that have completed both core and level 1. there is one student that, you know, had a great joy to have him in class. And when we finished the core, there were some events that conflicted with the schedule. But he had also had already signed up to join the Army. And so because of that, he had some things to do to prepare for that. And because he's going into the Army and learning another skill, the electrical was not a fit for him at this time. But Jeremy did complete the core. And so, I'm sorry, Jacob. Sorry, Jeremy. Jacob did complete. I've done this before. Jacob did complete the core, and Jacob's going to be, and I'm going to be sending Jacob's transcripts to grades to NCCER, and he's going to be starting to get that credential. It's going to take 6 to 8 weeks for that to come in. Okay, 6 to 8 weeks. I have to go through associate those contractors. They record it. They send everything off to the administrative feed to NCCER. They have to process it through the national database. That takes time. So 6 to 8 weeks. When I get, and I'm going to have that sent back to me directly. When I receive that, I'm going to come to each one of you students and personally hand it over to you. Okay? I want to make sure you get it. So the best way to make sure you get it is by having come to me along with you. All right. So, but that doesn't mean you're not going to walk home. I do have some of my own certificates drawn up that I'll give you when you recognize. Okay. So, can I ask all my students to come up here? Please. Jacob. Yes. Absolutely. While on your journey, seek the wise wisdom of those that have traveled before you. Listen and learn from what they have said. By doing so, you'll be able to stand above the shoulders of the giants that are there ahead of you. As you walk on the path you have chosen, remember that the road ahead is paved with many new relationships, and you'll experience on that journey. I've been blessed to have many relationships with wise men, one that is here in this room with us today. Remember, there's no such thing as self-made success. We all heard the old saying, it's nothing personal, it's just business. Well, business is personal. It's about developing and nurturing good, healthy relationships in both your careers and your personal lives. Try never to be the smartest person on the job site or in the classroom should you consider pursuing a higher education. And if you are, I suggest you seek surrounding yourself with a few smarter people around you, or try taking some harder classes. As you continue traveling the road ahead, you must always remember where you came from. Each of us carries the junk and dreams of the things that help shape us. And all of us can also count the blessings our path has taken us so far. You don't know what the future ahead has in store for you, but you can look down the path for which you recently traveled and then turn around again to see with hope and great expectation the new direction you're headed. Finally, many times along the way, you're going to ask why. Why am I on this path? What is it all about? You'll be asking yourself these questions in 10 years, and in 20 years, as often as you're asking them now. Well, it's about fighting the good fight. It's about finishing the race. And it's about winning. But I'm not talking about the type of winning where you're gaining the most points. I'm talking about winning in a contest with your own potential. I'm talking about believing in yourself enough to become the best electrician, engineer, or possibly teacher someday that you can be. Talking about never measuring your success based on the success of others. If you do, you might be setting the bar too low. You might not know what your passion really is right now. Many people find their passion later in life, while others never find it at all. And for some, their greatest passion will suggest being on the journey searching. But whether you found your calling or if you're still searching, passion should be the fire that drives your life's work. The key to finding that passion is to listen to your heart, that smart voice that's inside of you. That the smart voice talking inside of you is God's Spirit who lives in each one of us. And let it carry you in the direction of your dreams. I've learned that it's possible to set your sights high, achieve your dreams, and do it with integrity, character, and love. And each day that you're moved toward your dreams without compromising who you are, you're winning. I was just a little older than you are now when I told myself that I wanted to become a master electrician. I didn't say I wanted to learn a little bit about the electrical trade or become a journeyman electrician. I knew that one day I wanted to be a master electrician. I didn't clearly understand why I had such a strong desire to become one so much at that time. But God had a plan for me, but God had a plan for what He wanted me to do. I've talked today about a journey, one that each one of us travels. We often travel together. But in the end, it's your journey. Your path to travel and your responsibilities along the way. You are free to choose. And you are free to become successful. It just takes hard work, a vision, listening to that voice, that smart voice inside you. Students have completed the SEAL and Olympic Trait program never imagine that they're going to change the world. Yet, every one of you will. How to change the world is all up to you to decide. I wish you all a great adventure on your day. So I want to call each one of you up, and I want to issue your certificate. And anybody who wants to take a picture, it's a good time. So, well, we can get off to the side and take pictures too afterwards. So Jonathan, just gonna hold that up. I learned a new term with Daniel in my class. I really like it. You all heard Gucci. Dennis, congratulations.
Did well on all your tests, and this
such a joy to have you in class. And so you'll be receiving a credential from NCCER and it'll be placed in the National Registry. And I also would like to award you this certificate, show that you have been through the CLM and achieve, you know, that credential also. And I also want to thank you for your service.
Yeah.
Jacob's going to be a medic. So, you know, when you get out of the Army and he has a medical knowledge, and he can speak that's a whole different language, you know. And he can speak that language and he knows something about that, that's a big future. I'd like to ask everybody if we can recognize Jacob and thank him and all of our service folks for what they do for our country. Everybody stand up.